Okay, let me start then. I'm very interested by the part of your talk, of course, on high frequency homogenization. And I wonder if you have any idea how this would translate into water wave equations. So, I mean, do you think that the same kind of, formalism would work for, non-linear water waves or,
Actually, I've never thought about it, but the with non-linearity, I don't know if it's that easy since for this work everything was performed in the frequency with the frequency formulation, so it does not seem so obvious to me to transpose it to with non-linearities, but actually I don't really know.
Okay, this would be essentially trying to model this this water wave with some kinds of spring mass models. I mean, it would be very, I think, very, very interesting to be very, to have some kind of bold proposal that you can somehow model certain types of nonlinear water waves. But I don't know. That's just some possibility like that. And regarding the work on high frequency homogenization also, so the main difference with what Craster has done back in 2010 is that essentially now you have this this kind of interface condition, so with this eta not parameter in there. So how much does it differ in terms of the general algorithm? I mean, where do you have real technical problems in the usual algorithms? Where does it stand?
For example, when you consider the eigenvalue problem, the main difference is that you will have a new inner product that will take into account the interface conditions, and then it's the main difference is that you will have to use the jump conditions, for example, to prove the fact that the first order term in the case of a simple eigenvalue is equal to zero. So it comes from the fact that we have perfect jump conditions in the original work. So here you have to combine both the jump conditions in order to make this term vanish too. And yes, mainly it's the main differences.
Okay, that's really nice. And what is very impressive is that you also treated the case of close to touching bands. I mean, even in the, I mean, I know that it's really tricky, this nearby eigenvalue case. And so why is there such a nice fit of the dispersion of the dispersion curves in that case? I mean, why does it work better for nearby eigenvalues? I don't understand why.
Because you have so when you look at the nearby eigenvalue case, then you have a kind of linear corrector. So that's why you have a better fit along the for a wide range of frequency, whereas in the simple eigenvalue case, you just get the quadratic
Oh
term.
Yes. Okay. Okay. All right. But so the trivial question, would be why don't you apply that scheme to make your simple eigenvalue approximation better?
Yes, you mean to go to...
Well, of course, so you could replicate what you have done for nearby eigenvalues and to improve the simple eigenvalue approximation, no?
I don't know, because for the nearby eigenvalue approximation, the main thing is that you assume that you also have a scaling in delta between the two eigenvalues. So you can just take the contribution and put it for the simple one, because In all the equation, you have to consider the two eigenvalues, and also you decompose the solution on both associated eigenfunctions. So it's really linked to the fact that you have two eigenvalues.
Okay. And so why not applying some kind of high order, high frequency approximation to improve the simple eigenvalue approximation then? I mean, would that work to go to higher order correcting terms?
Yes, probably. I think it would be a lot of work in order to go to get higher order terms. But yes, the way would be to have a higher order approximation, and even for the nearby one, indeed, because with the nearby approximation, we have the linear corrector. But the fact is, the quadratic term, if you look really close to the edges, is not exactly the same than for the simple eigenvalue approximation. And the exact one is the one of the simple eigenvalue case, not the one of the nearby one. It seems to be really better with the nearby eigenvalues because you have the linear correction. But if we go really close to the edges, the quadratic term is not really well taken into account. So if we go to higher order homogenization, then maybe we could also correct this quadratic term for the nearby eigenvalue case.
And also, obviously, another trivial question. Can you translate what you have done into the biperiodic and triperiodic case? I mean, here it's just a chain, no? It's a periodic chain. So now what happens if you have a doubly periodic array? What is there just some kind of...
So in higher dimensions?
Yeah, higher dimension.
So I think there will be no... big difference, but the big one will be about the fact that for the nearby eigenvalues, it won't be just two nearby eigenvalues, but a cluster of eigenvalues, since you can have many of them. But then I think the method will be comparable. And for perfect interfaces, it has been done for higher dimensions.
Okay. Okay, so I should, give the opportunity to other people to ask their questions, because it's really an inspiration what you have done. And of course, I guess that, I mean, what you have done can be transposed straightforwardly to the electromagnetic case. I mean, your equation would work in the same way in the electromagnetic case, isn't it? It's a generic equation that you have. I mean, the spring
yes.
mass models, they are used as well in electromagnetics, you know.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah. But I think it can be really transposed to some water wave problem. I mean, I think there is a... I mean, you have here, you have developed a machinery which can be universal, you know. Okay, so no questions, people?
Maybe I have a quick question, if I may.
Yes, please.
Yeah, thanks for the talk. My question was about, so when you have this interface problem and you're doing it with like homogeneous, some homogeneous medium going off to infinity at both the left and the right, if you change that to have, I don't know, something inhomogeneous but periodic, I don't know what, like would your method still work? What would change about it?
So just to be sure, it's about this part.
Yeah, exactly. So you know, you've got this blue background, and that goes off to infinity, both the left and the right. If you replace that with, I don't know, something periodic, so something that's easy to model but is not homogeneous, could you still use these techniques?
I assume that maybe we would have to homogenize the periodic medium and then to have the jump conditions to combine both homogenization.
Yeah, sure.
But maybe you can, yes. consider the propagation of waves in the first medium and then consider the microstructured array.
And then sort of glue the different homogeneous, the sort of different homogenized solutions together.
Yes, I don't know exactly, but
yeah, we're talking very vaguely. Thanks. Okay, it's interesting.
Thank you so much, Bryn, for this interesting comments. So, I mean, we welcome questions, of course, from engineers, physicists. So we had mathematicians. So, okay, I've got another very trivial question, you know, from the layman. So when I look at your optimization process, so you carried out the optimization with what kind of algorithm? I mean, it's some kind of topological optimization that you apply?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, topological optimization.
Yeah, and because, you know, nowadays people also look at this kind of machine learning techniques, you know. Have you thought about that? I mean, essentially, this is an inverse problem, you know. So now they have this neural network, topical methods. And, I mean, so what is the advantage of using, for instance, a neural network over your optimization algorithm? I mean, maybe, you know, you want to generate to solve many, many, many direct problems. You train, you know, your neural network, and then solving the inverse problem would be just straightforward, you know, isn't it?
Yes, maybe also it would be interesting in order to avoid some local minima that we meet when we use this optimization algorithm, because the functional is decreased, but actually we can very easily go to a local minima, which is not the best configuration. So maybe it would be also interesting for this reason.
And, you know, it's reminiscent of an oxetic medium, the structure you get, you know, somehow the basic cell looks a bit like what you would get for an oxetic medium, no? No, perhaps not.
Actually, to be honest, I'm not sure I can really give a meaning about the microstructure in this case. It's really a preliminary result, and the functional is decreased, and it was also a validation step of the fact that the optimization works well, and that we also can reach a smooth configuration with a well-chosen volume constraint. But I'm not sure that I can give an interpretation of the microstructure. And also, it's hard sometimes to find an interpretation, because then everything is repeated periodically, but just with one row, so it's not that intuitive.
And yeah, it's quite amazing to see how your initial unit cell is, you know, transformed into this final unit. I mean, it has nothing in common. I mean, it's
yes.
I would have, you know, perhaps imagine a cross or an elongated. I mean, but this is topologically even is totally different. No, it's yeah. It's,
yes.
But like you said, perhaps you have a whole class of very different geometries leading to similar, you know, local minima.
Yes, I think it's one problem also to get some macroscopic effects. Or maybe it would be interesting to try other cost functional.
One last thing before, I mean, people, please come forward with your questions. You know, I keep talking, blah 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 blah. But so you mentioned at some point that you were penalizing. I can't remember where your problem. You needed to apply some penalization to. Where was it again? To reach some kind of.
So it's because when I apply the optimization just with just with a volume target ratio and a given reflection. So this is
Yes.
functional. I have this kind of final configuration, which is really not smooth. So in
Yes.
order to have smoother configuration, I add a penalization of the perimeter so that it gives a smoother configuration. We don't have like these small sharp lines.
But then you have checks that you know when your penalization parameter is smaller and smaller, you I mean reach some kind of convergence towards
Yes. Yes,
so
I
in
can.
so you confirm that the solution here is very close to the solution of your original problem. You're not solving a different problem by having a penalization.
No, I played on this penalization parameter in order to have a smoother configuration. But for example, if it's too large, I will have I don't know, just a colon of black. And in this case, it's true that it's a completely different problem. But mathematically, it's not exactly the same problem. But I've chosen the parameter in order to just smoother the final configuration.
Okay, very interesting. And for people, I think because maybe not everyone was attending your PhD Viva, I would like to remind people, it seems to me that, I mean, this is all your work in terms of computational, resources. I mean, you did not use some kind of commercial package, did you?
No.
Yeah. So there was an awful lot amount of computational resources involved, I guess, to achieve this result. Okay. Now, I mean, I've got, I mean, it's, out of curiosity, what will be your next move in terms of applying these techniques? I mean, I can understand that you want to refine this computation, but what else do you want to solve in the near future kind of problem?
In terms of optimization,
Yeah.
so as I mentioned, maybe it would be more interesting to apply optimization, for example, to the resonant case because it would allow to have more important macroscopic effects. Because with this non-resonant configuration, I don't think we can get a strong macroscopic effect. I just gave an example, but we can have a strong directional effect, or we can play on the absorption, for example, as I mentioned in the resonant case. So it could be interesting, or also to consider an interface with varying properties in order to get this time directional effects, which is not, I think, possible to get, I mean, strong directional effects for the non-resonant case.
And can you envisage to achieve some periodic structures that would have some doubly negative parameters in certain frequency range? I mean, so your two parameters in your equation turn negative at the same frequency.
I don't know really what it means for microstructured array, because doubly negative generally it's for the bulk metamaterials, but here it's replaced by effective jump conditions, so I don't know exactly how to transpose it to the case of jump conditions. That's what is difficult too in this case of interfaces, like to know on which microscopic quantity to work in order to have interesting effects.
So you cannot reach a similar effect to a negative refraction in a volume with interfaces, just with interfaces. So for instance, let us imagine for one moment that you want to achieve the Pendry-Vaisselago lens, this lens with n equals minus one. Could you envisage just working on the interfaces, the two interfaces, not within the volume, and getting somehow a similar effect to the
But maybe Maybe with varying properties along the interface. With a periodic one, I don't think so. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so with a periodic interface. I think it's more about interfaces with varying properties if we want to reach some unusual reflection properties.
But in fact, it seems to me that, you know, there are two, I mean, two sides, two types of effects in this perfect lens. So you have the ray picture, okay? You have the ray picture when you can see the doubly focusing effect. But also, you know, you have the effects of the plasmonic resonances. And so you could already somehow, you know, achieve some kind of super lens effect just by placing your source very close to your structured interface. You don't need to grade it. It needs,
Okay.
and the fact that you make sure that you have a surface plasmon on the first one, first interface, and a surface plasmon on the second interface, I think you would already achieve some deeply sub-wavelength image on the other side.
Yes, maybe because in fact, what I didn't mention in this presentation is that when I have a source point, I didn't homogenize the source in my work. So when I have a source point, I assume that it's quite far in the homogeneous
Ah,
part.
so it's not in the near field.
No, so maybe the difference is also that if we would have to consider the source in the homogenization process in order to get this effect.
The fact that you achieve this kind of resonant effects is intimately linked with some kind of gluing conditions, some kind of match asymptotic techniques, isn't it? You've got to be really careful with that. So you on the one hand, you solve this annex problem just like you would do for volume homogenization, but on the other hand, you have to glue this solution with the solution in the homogeneous outer space. And
Yes.
so,
Yes,
okay.
everything is due to the fact that you match two different expansions,
Yeah.
and one will involve the cell problems that we usually static cell problems that we usually have for bulk materials, and when we match them, we have these jump conditions that appear.
So really, in fact, what I would say is that your result, they encompass within them already the volume homogenization somewhere, because doing this, it's a step, one more step, you know, compared to volume homogenization.
Yes, maybe in the inner region it's kind of
You could well imagine that the inner region would be filled with your, you know, the same cell as you have on your structured interface, and you have already the result for this, but except that now you don't need to glue it to, no?
So yes, maybe taking directly the inner field so without looking for jump conditions. Yes, probably.
Okay, so, yeah, so there is one thing perhaps that you know that is kind of ongoing work. It's you can also achieve, you know, some kind of cloaking effect now. Maybe you've heard about that. So if you have some doubly negative parameters and you have some kind of region of space with negatively refracting medium, if you place some small diffracting objects close by, you can just console the scattering. And so perhaps your techniques could be applied to these problems, no?
It's like a circular. It
Oh,
would
it doesn't
have
need to
to.
be circular. It can be just even take the slab lens. You have the slab lens and you place some objects just close by the negatively refracting slab lens. And if you send a plane wave, okay, if you send a plane wave and you just have the slab lens, then the plane wave will just see a transparent medium. It won't be affected. And now if you place some small diffracting object nearby, you will have some kind of you know, cancellation of the scattering field emitted by this small object due to the fact that you have the plasmonic resonance. You would see this cloaking effect even with a configuration similar to what you have achieved already. And perhaps even I was thinking that, you know, it would be enough to have just a seen interface and a structured seen interface with this doubly negative medium would already achieve this cloaking effect. So you would be extremely close to be able to solve an external one-dimensional cloak problem.
Okay.
So, yeah. I mean, I can see a lot of potential in your techniques because you treat high contrast problems. You have all the toolbox to, you know, engineer matter so that you achieve this this kind of space folding or cloaking problems. Okay. People, I'm sure that you have some questions to ask, like me. I am very excited by what Dr. Tuboul does, but obviously we have here some experts we could... And so for your optimization algorithm, you could apply your optimization algorithm to something like... a unit cell starting from a split ring resonator or things like that. So instead of starting from an initial unit cell which has a disk in the center, you would have a different a high contrast structure or
No, but I work with a fixed physical properties, so I just play on the topology and the geometry afterwards. So I have to keep the same physical properties along the iteration. And here, this work is in the low contrast case.
But you can also, tell me if I'm totally wrong, you can also apply your result of the low contrast case to, you know, an optimization where you increase the contrast between the cases, the phases, but just keeping the same, you know, algorithm of low contrast, you can still push the contrast, can't you? Without
yes.
applying high contrast homogenization, because high contrast homogenization is some kind of idealized case, no?
Yes, so it would require to change a cost functional at each time, but maybe it could be.
And so in this case, you know, to achieve perhaps the doubly negative effect in the two parameters, essentially you need something that creates a monopole and something that creates a dipole. And so you would need the two ingredients in your case might be that you would have so you would need two inclusions in your cell, one which would look like pretty much like a split ring and the other one which would be like a high contrast phase. And with this kind of perhaps unit cell, you might converge towards a cell that would achieve the desired effect. And then you would have this kind of great, you know, unit cell with two types of inclusions inside. And you would have just one interface consisting of these cells, and then you would send a plane wave on this. And first, it would be transparent at certain frequency, and then when you would place some small scattering object in front of this structured interface, you would cloak these scattering objects, and then that would be a fantastic achievement. And then you could conformally map this interface onto some corona. And that would be your cylindrical external cloak. Because when you use a conformal mapping, you know, you don't say essentially bring any unwanted anisotropy to your problem. I mean, you can. I mean, I think this would be a nice direction for you, perhaps, to think of this.
Yes.
Okay, enough. So I hope that people will have the opportunity to watch your talk later on, because I think it's extremely useful for a whole community of applied mathematicians and engineers. And yeah, thank you so much, Marie, for this extremely inspirational work. I'm very impressed by what you have achieved together with Cédric Bélis and Bruno Lombard.
Thank
It's,
you.
I mean, like people said during your viva, it's totally amazing this amount of work that has been produced. Okay, perhaps Bogdan, you can remind people who will be our next speaker. I think he's someone from Imperial College. Okay, so I think it will be Bryn Davies, our very own Bryn Davies, will be our next webinar speaker. And Bryn has a background similar to Dr. Tugul's background, so it will be well in line with your talk, Marie. So thank you very much, people, for attending this session, and stay safe. Bye-bye.